Hello, my name is Steven. Welcome to Hyfindr Tech Talks, where we aim to understand the technology that makes the hydrogen economy work. Well, there are fuel cell systems in the hydrogen economy that do very important things, but how do you even make these work? And today, we have somebody who has done that several times. He works for AE Driven, an integrator for such kind of systems. He has run several projects. He's an engineer by background. I'm very pleased to welcome Christoph Ley.
Thank you, Steven.
Welcome, Christoph. So you've actually left your workshop and your tools behind to come here today. This is a particular pleasure. Thank you very much for that. And to start straight out, how do I design a fuel cell system?
To keep it easy, Steven, let's talk about the basics, a PEM fuel cell.
So PEM fuel cell.
Exactly.
Okay.
A PEM fuel cell.
What is a PEM?
This is polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell.
Ah, yeah, okay. So not SOFC. This is the, okay, right.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So at first, we need to talk about the things that we need for running the fuel cell itself. So we have the anode side at the fuel cell where we put in the hydrogen. Then we have the cathode side where we put in air or the oxygen that is in the air. Then there is the catalyst in the middle, and we have a reaction between the oxygen and the hydrogen. So there are also things that come out of the fuel cell that is oxygen and water out of the cathode side, and that is the surplus hydrogen and some water drops on the anode side. That's because we put a little bit more hydrogen in it, and a little bit comes out, and we want to take it back. And there is also the energy, the electrical power that is generated, and there is heat.
Okay, so this is the very core of the fuel cell system, which I see has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in and outputs, right?
Exactly.
Okay, so we've understood the basics, but again, the target was to make a whole system.
Exactly. So we need a lot of components to get this running, and let's have a look at the next page.
Okay, this looks more complicated. This is the balance of plant, as we call it, right?
We can see here the whole system, including the balance of plant, and this is a P&ID, a piping and instrumentation diagram. We can go through it, so just some details.
Sorry to interrupt you. Can you help us again? What exactly is the balance of plant?
So the balance of plant contains all components in the system, so in the anode system, in the cathode system, and also in the cooling system to run the fuel cell.
Okay, so which parts are those?
So let's start at the anode loop.
Okay.
So we can start here. Mm-hmm. So hydrogen comes into the system out of a tank normally. So then we start with the first component, that's the isolation valve.
Okay, sorry to jump in again, but this is the anode system is essentially the hydrogen supply circulation system, and the hydrogen comes in here from a tank.
Exactly.
The storage here, essentially.
Exactly when that would be a vehicle application, it comes with 700 bar into this system.
Yes.
So then we go through the isolation valve. That's a kind of stopper or kind of blocker. So for stopping that it comes in or also that the gas can go back.
Yes.
So then we go into the distribution valve. So and then we start changing the pressure. So down to a level that is suitable for the anode. Mm-hmm. So because we cannot work with 700 bar inside of the anode, otherwise there would be some damages in the membrane and something. So we need a pressure regulator. That is a pressure regulator.
Takes the pressure down from 700 to whatever other...
Exactly, depending on the stack.
What kind of pressures do you usually see here?
That's depending on the operations operation strategy, and if we work in the pressure mode. So on this side, it is 0.2 bar higher than on the cathode side, but let's talk about later.
Okay.
Exactly.
Right. Okay.
So then we go into... Then we go into this tank, into the anode inlet. Mm-hmm. So there in this tank, there is this reaction. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned before, we put a little bit more hydrogen in the anode so that it's working very, very good. Mm-hmm. Then the rest that was not used mm-hmm. comes out mm-hmm. with some drops because there is water is produced in, yeah. in this or during this reaction. Mm-hmm. So we take out some drops and go into a water separator.
Okay.
So there we replace the drops. Mm-hmm. The rest of the hydrogen is used or is transported back to a recirculation blower. So that means we do not waste the hydrogen that was not used. We take it back, change the pressure, and take it back to the anode side. So a kind of loop. That is a kind of loop here. Yes.
So that is the anode loop, meaning the hydrogen loops like that with these components.
Exactly.
All right. Okay.
Exactly. And then there are also some mechanisms like purge and drain. So that mm-hmm. means here we have a purge and drain valve, purge and drain valves to get out the water drops and so on.
All right, the water exactly. is collected here in the water separator.
Exactly, okay. exactly. Yeah. So okay. let's have a look at the cathode side, so the air system, the air to side. Keep it in easy words.
Yeah.
Exactly. So we take the dry air that is in the environment.
Yes.
We do it in a filter,
mm-hmm.
then in a compressor because we need the pressure in the inside of the stack. But during compressing the air, it's getting hot.
Mm-hmm.
Air is getting hot, so that is why we need an intercooler here.
Mm-hmm.
Then after the intercooler, we go into a humidifier to get wet air mm-hmm. for the reaction. We need wet air, then it's working very, very good.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go through a pressure regulator, this is the normal way here, through yeah. the pressure regulator to have the right pressure, and then in the cathode okay. side.
All
so
right.
that mm-hmm. is how the wet air comes into the cathode side, and then in the stack there's the reaction between oxygen on this side and the hydrogen from the other side.
Okay.
Exactly. So we use the air also for transporting out the water mm-hmm. out of the stack.
Mm-hmm.
So that means at first on the outlet of the cathode side, we go back in the humidifier.
Yes.
And that is very interesting. We need water in the humidifier to mm-hmm. get the air from on the inlet humidified.
Uh-huh.
So we do not put it with a can inside
yeah.
of the humidifier.
Yeah.
We just use the humidity or the drops out of the cathode.
Ah, okay, exactly. So the dry air coming in, or let me see, this dry air is humidified, and here it gets even more humidified due to the reaction.
Yeah? Exactly.
Hydrogen, oxygen, water.
Exactly.
Okay, so that's the water that's coming out there, and that's humidified.
Understood. Exactly.
Understood. Okay.
Exactly. And then the rest of the air that is not used here in the humidifier and in the part of the system goes out here
okay.
to the wet air outlet. But there are also some other systems.
Mm-hmm.
So let's go back here.
Mm-hmm.
You can see the blue box here.
Yes.
That is the cooling loop.
Aha.
Because when we're talking about, an example, 50% efficiency of a fuel cell stack, that means we get 50% out power, so electrical energy that can be used later,
mm-hmm.
and the rest is heat. So that means we need to cool down the stack, and
mm-hmm.
that is how we do it.
Mm-hmm.
So at first we go in a radiator.
Mm-hmm.
So from the radiator in different valves here.
Mm-hmm.
So there's also a pressure compensation container. There's an ion exchanger because there are several requirements to the coolant medium that is used in the fuel cell stack.
Mm-hmm.
We go in the intercooler that is connected to the cathode system, and then with a coolant pump back into the stack.
Mm-hmm. So essentially you're running the coolant through the stack to take out the heat, and you use the radiator to get it off.
Exactly.
And then you cycle it. And what exactly does the ion exchanger do?
So there's a conductivity requirement for the coolant medium.
Mm-hmm.
So it needs to be smaller than 5 micro Siemens.
Yes.
To fulfill this requirement, we need a kind of filter. Uh-huh. And this filter is the ion exchanger.
Okay, so to avoid a short circuit.
Exactly. Exactly. Otherwise, exactly. Otherwise, it would be possible to get a short circuit.
Okay.
Exactly. So then, going on the top.
Yeah. Speaking of circuits.
Speaking of circuits, yes. To the so we call it power control and power electronics here.
Mm-hmm.
This, so we get out electricity out of this tech, and we need something to work with it. So, in example, when we're working with a high voltage battery, we need to change the voltage level or transform the voltage level from this tech to a suitable level of the battery. So yes, that is why we need a DC-DC. And there are also other power electronic devices, so converters, an example, to provide the energy for, in example, the pumps.
So I see you have the DC-DC converter. Incidentally, we also have a video which we made on DC-DC converters, so also interesting to watch. But I see here you have several of them. So to the battery, and here another one. You need another one here.
Yes, exactly. So we go here into DC-AC.
DC-AC, that is.
That is DC-AC, exactly, to run the recirculation motor. Exactly. Okay. So there's also a power demand inside of the subsystems, and we use the power that is generated by the stack.
Yes.
We use this power, transform it to run the system components.
Okay. Okay. Wow. Okay. That looks like quite a setup, but I think I've got it. That to you run these cycles, and now how would you then go about putting this balance of plant? Help me again. Balance of plant is everything apart from the stack, or
the balance of plant is the part around the stack.
Around the stack.
Around the stack. Okay. So you can have the best stack from the world, the best stack, but without a very good balance of plant, it's nearly useless.
Just a piece of metal. Okay. So how would you get, to make it useful? How would you get this then to a stage where you have all the right components in place and then it's actually working?
I can show it, Stephen. Mm-hmm. So let's go to the next slide. Exactly. So the question is, that is the goal. So we want to have a fuel cell system with a balance of plant, including the balance of plant. And the question is how to design it. And we do not take a catalog and look, okay, here's a pump and there's a blower and so on. We do it with a simulation model.
Yeah.
So, and the first question is, what is the requirement and the demand? So what is the power demand that should be produced by the whole system?
Yeah.
Exactly. So in a vehicle application, that could be a load profile. So that means we use the load profile in a simulation environment. We can show it here, or I can show it here. So in the background, there is this graphic about this load profile.
Can we just zoom that in or try that? Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. So what a load profile means, how much energy is required at what time?
So how much power or energy is required at what time and so on, and this in a special period. Exactly. So we use this and go with it into a simulation environment. So this is a basic model. At first, this is a basic model. So that means there are all components in the balance of plant that are necessary to run the fuel cell stack. So, but these are kind of generic components. So then with the load profile and with the input into the simulation model, we get a kind of requirements sheet. So that means there's the information, what compressor do we need? What is the mass flow? And
yes,
so on.
Yes,
so the several parameters for designing the fuel cell system.
Okay. So it's a This is a bit mathematical simulation
Exactly.
Okay, where you can run or simulate different parts of that system which we just saw before.
Exactly. And then, but that is not the final status of it. So the next level is we have the requirements on the first side, but now the goal is to find suitable components. So an example, when we're talking about a compressor, you will not exactly find the compressor that fits exactly to the specification there. So that means you go in contact with different suppliers, compressor suppliers, and they send you normally the performance maps. We insert the performance maps into the simulation model, and in the end, we get a very precise simulation model, so the next iteration. It's called iteration, and this is a kind of digital twin. Mm-hmm. Let's call it like this.
So speaking of digital and choosing between, I mean, just to mention, I mean, you may not know this, but this is exactly where, let me say, Hyfindr is trying to add value, that when the engineers are now selecting different components, they can actually find different options on Hyfindr. And yeah, and then when they find one, then they'll do what you ask them to do, or they'll contact you so that they help it put it together. But please go on. Yes.
Exactly. So that means just the steps back. So first there was the requirement, then there was the basic simulation.
Yes.
Then we modified the simulation model to this digital twin. Now we can create different concepts to make the system very efficient, in example, to find components that are very efficient. Or we can take decisions about do we want to run it in a static operation mode or operating mode or more dynamically, mm-hmm. and so on. Mm-hmm. So these are different concepts, and we have the KPIs on hand to decide it.
Yeah, okay, understood.
Exactly. So, and when we go to the next slide, So this is the process again here, just very easy. So we start with a simulation, with a basic simulation. We insert the system requirements like load profiles and so on. We start with the first sizing of the simulation model. Then we select a concept, and there are several iterations to design the system.
Okay, wow. All right, wow, that is that was a really fast flow through the entire way, yeah? So I see you've done this several times. How long do you normally take to run through all this, get all this data? What is a typical development cycle for this?
So let's talk first about the simulation model.
Yeah.
We have the simulation model on hand, so that means we put a lot of work in it to have the kind of base frame for it. Right. When you start at point zero, you need a lot of time and also experience to build it, to set it up, and so on. We use our existing model, and then we can start directly, and within 3 to 4 weeks, we get the first results.
Of components that you would need to put
components
out,
concepts and so on. So we have after 4 weeks we have the base for taking decisions with KPIs and so on. So what is interesting for a customer? So an example, hydrogen consumption,
size
of the fuel cell, and so on.
Oh, okay, very interesting. And so, which part is, I mean, since you've done this a couple of times, what is the hardest part of this?
Or
like where the one where I would say the most night shifts get into.
As mentioned, we need the performance maps and we need suitable components and so on. Yeah. So that is also the field in what you're working to push this hydrogen business.
Yes.
And to find suppliers with suitable products for these applications. That is very, very hard, or this is a kind of challenge, let's call it like this.
Yeah.
So because this is not that we take one concept out of the shelf.
We design
customized systems that are very suitable for the customer applications.
Mm-hmm. Okay, okay. Wow, that was super interesting, Christoph. I mean, this makes us almost hungry for more, to learn more about this. But I think for now, you've done a fantastic job of taking us from the simple fuel cell right at the beginning through the various development steps on how to create the balance of plant, how to make it all fit together, and the kind of simulation models and things that you need to get going. So, Christoph, thank you so much.
Thank you, Steven.
That was amazing. If you want to get in contact with Christoph or find components, as we have rightly identified here, Hyfindr is a place that truly is there to help to advance this entire industry. We hope that it is of service. We hope this video is of service to you. If you like it, or if you have liked it, please drop us a hint or subscribe or give us some form of kudos or the other. Thank you anyway for your time watching, and we will make more videos, and Christoph, I hope you will be back. to tell us even more.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for watching. Goodbye.